lobby. Obviously move around as you feel comfortable, but if you want to perch yourself on that desk at any stage, I'm setting the camera up. Alright, we are ready. So welcome everybody, thank you. Thank you for giving up your time as well, not just Bobby. Thank you for coming here in an attempt to educate yourself and make yourselves more knowledgeable soccer parents and soccer kids. So this is why we're here tonight. And this is what Bobby can offer us guidance on, more so than myself, and on something more so than anybody that I'm aware of. So here we go. Who is that handsome chap? Believe that? Like a model playing soccer. So this is why Bobby's here. The first thing we're going to go over, and Bobby and I talked about this the other day, what it took and what it was like to be a pro in England. Hopefully that interests you guys. What it took for his son Gabe to make it onto the US national team and now play pro in England for Reading. We're going to talk about the US soccer system, which is complicated, and you know, we want to provide some clarity on that. And also the differences between the systems in England and the States. We're going to talk a little bit about parenting, and you know, we had a good laugh when we talked about this the other day. Bobby did have an interesting time being a parent, especially as a pro in his first year. And the last thing that we'll talk about is what you need to know about player development and what Bobby believes about. So I will guide this, and if any of you have any questions at any point, then raise your hand. But this is who we have in front of us. Bobby played in what is now called the Premier League. First division back in the day. But Bobby played in the Premier League 10 years, probably 14 years as a pro, 14 years. Norwich, Coventry and Forest is his main club. This is the one that I'm most impressed with, England under 21 national team, so we've got to wear a jersey for our country. And here we go, England. Winner of the goal of the season, and if I read the article correctly, it said that you were most proud of this because it's only given out once.
Well, yeah, one person in the meeting.
One person in the meeting. You both want to see the goal?
Yes.
I want you to notice how short the shorts
are. They're like daisy boots. So this is it. This is what won it.
It was my 52nd birthday yesterday, and you know, I knew at 8 years old, watching West Germany win the World Cup. I'm half German, my mum's German. That was the time when I felt I want to be a professional soccer player. And I think as parents, we have to all support our kids through it. Whether they want to be, they want to be in the orchestra, they want to be their doctor, they want to be a professional soccer player, we can support their dreams. My mum supported my dream. She never ever wavered from I was going to be a professional soccer player. Now my dad was like crazy, you know, he was just like school. And I understood what he was talking about. Obviously I come from a country where our culture is soccer is the be all and end all. It's more important than life and death. You know, so I grew up in a culture just like Lynn where, you know, we come out and we're playing soccer as soon as we can walk. Three main sports in England are soccer, football, rugby and cricket. Only the well-off play cricket. And, but most English kids want to be professional soccer players. It's just something. And so for me, it was very simple. We didn't have many things back in the 70s, as you can imagine. And so all I had was my ball. And I just spent countless hours. There is a, if you ever Google it, there is a thing called the 10,000 hour rules. If anything that you want to be successful at, you've got to put about 10,000 hours to figure that out. And so for me, the only thing wrong with this culture right now, I think there's so many things for the kids to do other than going to the park and playing soccer or playing sport. They've got so much in their play. We barely had a TV, which you would have done to my ear. It was just, my best friend was a ball in the garden. I spent all day in the ball. Tennis ball, dribbling around my house, annoying my mum, breaking windows. But that's why I got the love for it. So in England, it's a much simpler way to get through to being a professional soccer player. There are so many professional clubs in England. There's 92 professional clubs. And there are hundreds of semi-pro clubs. And so there are many ways to get through. Obviously, you do the same thing in every country. You go up the ladder. At 14 years old, I had trials for Tottenham Hotspur, the Spurs fans here. Another, Harry Kane. You like Harry Kane? Golly, that boy was born to score. And so I went trials with Spurs, Watford, were in the EPL, and then Brentford. And really, I want you to understand that at the core of everything, you have to understand that kids are going to have highs and lows. And so, you know, I went through the youth system, and in the 80s, it wasn't much about school, and the coaches said to my parents, you've got to make a commitment to soccer or school. My dad said school. And you might be bored about it here, huh? And so what I did is I went into semi-pro at 17 years old. I dropped from the kind of the pro clubs, and I went into semi-pro. And then I played 12 games, and the scouts came, and I signed a contract for about 3 months. Yeah, I signed a pro contract at 17. Worked my way through the Norwich youth team, reserve team, first team, and made my debut at 18 years in 1 month. So I was a baby. But it was an amazing time for me, and my dreams came true. And so, you know, just following what Lynn said, there are kind of six things I kind of whittle things down to of what you need to be successful. And then if you're not successful as a pro soccer player, this will go through to them being successful as well. So there are tangibles and intangibles. And the three most important qualities I think the players need technically is their first touch, how they control the ball. And the second one is how they pass the ball. And then the third one is movement. And if you watch all the great soccer games, you guys watch the Champions League? So good. If you really watch the Champions League, they will show you the best players in the world. The game is actually very simple at the highest level. It's very complex at the younger levels. The kids are trying to fiddle around everyone and do so much of the ball. Whereas when you go at the highest level, they actually touch the ball less. They move the ball quickly, they pass the ball quickly. So you need those three qualities. Great first touch, great vision in passing, fantastic movement. So the next time you watch a Champions League game, I give the kids homework to do. And I ask them to sit down and just for 5 minutes, shout out loud. Every time someone touches the ball, I want them to count how many touches they have. Then it goes something like this. 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 1, 1, 1, 2. And if you did the same thing in a youth game, it would probably be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, lost the ball. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know. So you get what I'm saying? It is really at the highest level, the guys play fast, simple, less touches, great movement. So they're the three qualities that these kids should be working on and the coach should be working on. You know, I can't remember the last time I saw anyone jump a ball in the middle of a game around 10 people in school, you know. So you have to know what the most important things are, first touch and pass. And then there's intangibles. And they're things that we can't necessarily coach, but we can encourage. Know, and really, it's how you raise the kids. I'm a parent, first of all, as a 19-year-old and an 18-year-old, and there are many ways to skin a cat. I wouldn't let anyone tell me how to raise my kid. I would never tell you how to raise your kid. You know, but we have to help these kids be successful. And for me, when the parents raise them a certain way, it makes my job easier. And really, it is, we need them to have a very fast, sharp mind. We also want them to be, have a big heart. We can't really coach that. We need that in school. I think we need that in life. But we really want them to have a good heart. You know, a passion for what they do. Their integrity. Their work ethic. And so as parents, you know, my support system were teachers and coaches. And I wanted to make sure that they were on the same page as me, that we want to raise our kids to be, you know, sharp, to be tough, to care about what they do, bring passion for the time they stay on the field. And then the other one is really, again, it's that toughness, inner toughness. You know, not toughness being a bully or hurting people, but, you know, they're saying when you knock someone down, how quickly do they get back up? How much do they want to overcome obstacles? The big man upstairs, I'm sure most of you are religious. I found that out when I came from England to the South. You know, I'm a Catholic boy, and I think the big man upstairs, he puts things in our ways so that the kids can view certain characteristics and overcome them. You know, you find out more about yourself when you're losing. You find out more about yourself when you're half the size of them. And really, it's about what they can do bring to the table about not letting people overwhelm them, standing up for themselves. And they're the kind of things that we as coaches encourage in our training session, however we do it. But really, we need the kids to kind of take ownership of that. That makes sense. So, again, there's the tangibles and the intangibles. And really, they're really the kind of things I narrow things down to make you successful soccer players.
Thanks, Bobby. Nice and clear, I think. Anyone got any questions, by the way?
Just to give you a heads up, just to give you just a little bit more on this. So I retired in England after 14 years. I had a bad knee, so I had a knee. And this is how I came over to America. And so I played close to about 300 games in the Carrot Cup games and stuff like that. And then around 30, I had a serious knee operation. And so I came over to America to rehab. Had to go back to England to have another operation. And then I didn't know what to do because I retired in England after 14 years. I'm like, oh my gosh, what can I do? Because I can't do anything else. I can't change the light bulb. I can't fix the car. And I'm not doing anything else. So I came over here. Wanted to learn how to be a coach. So I said, be a coach, time. I love this country. You know, I'm still a British citizen. I have a green card here. Love this country. I feel like I'm half American. My son and my daughter are American. My son is in the line of flag right now. And so I spent 6 years here. Does anyone know the Carolina Dynamo? And Charleston Battery, in the middle of the time. So I played there for 6 years and then retired here and then met a beautiful American girl. So that's
it. Hi, I'm going to ask a question. At what point, like in general, is there a difference in England, if you will, or in any foreign country, where you're looking at a kid growing up 7, 8, 9, you mentioned one of the most expensive men in the world. Okay? Well, that's typically the kid that's standing out with the team. Is that the same type of thing from the coaches? Are they looking for that kid that has that technical doing that, or do they value the kid that's doing one much more, but maybe not on the ball as much?
Actually, no. They actually want the kids to do the dribbling. Now, me and Mike tell you something. It gets very subjective. But at the younger ages, we need to see that their techniques. It's all about technique at those ages, you know. So we want to know that they can control the ball, that they can master the ball. You know, there's a guy in Japan who is actually American. I don't know if anyone's seen the 30 for 30, I love that show. There's an American guy who goes to Japan and he's worked on a bit of the core stuff, you know, the core stuff. And really, it's about these kids getting a mastery of the ball, so they're in control of the ball. And so, they really don't worry the kids playing one or two, but as they develop and get older, now the game gets simpler, faster, and less touches. The coaches are really looking for the kids that have good coordination, good balance, you know, and then good technique, and then develop from there.
So there's three reasons that Bobby's here tonight. The first is because he has a unique perspective of what it's like to be a professional. The other reason is because I really like him. We've got a very good friendship when we were together in Colorado over the summer with the Raptors and stuff. I like and respect very much. And the third reason is he can talk not just as a parent of a soccer player, but the parent of a soccer player who's gone on to do what pretty much finished the parent. So we're just going to talk a little bit about Gabe, which is Bobby's son. So I just introduced Gabe and let Bobby talk about him. As you see here from the Rapids post back in 2017 in May, Gabe got called up to the US national team and went to Portugal, right? Went to Portugal to play. He's a goalkeeper. Wanted to buck against that a little bit, but apparently it worked out.
I begged him not to be a keeper.
it worked out okay. So Gabe got called up. He played for the Carolina Rapids Development Academy. We are going to talk about the Development Academy, but we're going to explain it since the coach of the Lord's voice. Gabe is now a US national team player, like Bobby, got on the jersey to represent his country. And currently, he is a professional with Reddit, which is a company that's a wonderful contract. This is Gabe. I just pulled this up from the online stuff for US soccer. It's much lighter. And then this came out in a national, I forget which one, maybe involved in a national soccer
tournament. Top draw.
Just players, top draw soccer. Where they were talking about, top prospects and where they were heading to college. And at the top of all of that, the very top of all of it was Gabe, who was at college. I don't think so. I'm going to get pro. The respect I sort of seen at my place. So Bobby, we're going to talk about the systems that you grew up in, the different system in England, the different system in the States, in a second. But personality-wise, you've done
very well. So the gate is very well. What are the differences and the similarities and what are the things that you think is an issue that should be like, yeah, especially if you hear it. When do you want to be a question from the brain?
That's important.
You know, never stop believing that dream. And I don't think it's right for anyone to stop them dreaming about that. You know, they'll figure out their time with something else they want to do. But as the coach, he's really discussed before that they want to do. And so, you know, I'm just so blessed. Big man upstairs blessed me. And not only for me to be a professional, but my son to follow my footsteps. Just a little bit of background. I am divorced from my wife, and I have a daughter, Amanda, and Gabriel. But we're still all close. And, but Gabe lived with me from the age of 8, so he's been with me. If you want, I only coached him for one season, and so I really can't take any credit for the technical side of this game. I give it all to the coaches. I give it all to the goalkeeper coaches. Josh writes about the next step, and that's the job. And he had the coaches at the Raptors. When he was 8, and he came to me, his mum never put him in soccer. I was so sad, guys. And so he went to his first tryout at the Raptors at 9. And he was the worst player in the world. And as you can imagine, as a young guy, my ego, I was heartbroken. And Coach Flanagan, who's our director of soccer, you know, we're good friends, and he sat down and he said, look, I'll put him on our, we had red, black, and white team. So he put on the white team, and he was the bottom of the roster of the white team. And I learned within that first year that as a parent, I could have made some changes to how I was related to my boy. I had to take me out of it. And for the first year, it was about me. I'm a voting state. And I was putting his success or failure and putting it on me. And it was terrible. It took me about a year to figure out that I was an idiot. And I wasn't trusting the process. And I wasn't trusting and accepting it who he was. And again, what we try and educate the parents to take themselves out of it, trust the kids, and trust the coaches, and trust the process. And no matter what, then you're going to love them. You know, in the first few months I'd get in the car, and I'm sure you've all been there, and you're putting your hair out, why didn't you do this, why didn't you do that? And there's a point where I look at something and ask, what do you do? So after the first year, I decided that I was going to just support him, not get in his way, not tell the coaches what to do, how to do it. I'm going to have to trust people. I have to trust the teachers. I have to trust the people he's around. And I have to let him go a little bit. And so after that, I just said, you know what, he's not going to be successful. Right? He's going to be successful. I'm okay with that. And then all of a sudden, he decided he wanted to be a goalkeeper, and I cried my eyes out. Are there any parents of goalkeepers here? It's heartbreaking, isn't it, guys? You know, the only good thing is you get good buttocks because you're tense all the time, because you're so nervous with them. You get what I'm saying? It's kind of like an exercise during the game, you know. Because being the parent of a goalkeeper is, oh gosh, you know, because if they make a mistake, it shoots your goal. And it is actually the most important position on the field. It's a tough position on the field. You're mentally strong and physically strong, you know. And so God bless you, parents, okay? And so he decided to be a goalkeeper. And then around the level 12, there was the first moment I went, and so from that moment, my job was just to, I didn't train him, I didn't coach him, I just mentored him. So when we got in the car, we would just talk about the game. And what I wanted, I had a plan that I felt like he could make it. So we had a plan I knew he could go to England and get a trial with a English club. Unfortunately, if these kids don't have a European parent, you can't get international players to go play in Europe. They have to do it through the US system. Because I'm an English father, he has citizenship for England. So I knew at some stage he could go back to England for tryouts. So when he was 13, he went to England on a trip with my U15. He did an international trip every year. He went to England, and we didn't have a goalkeeper for my U15, so that's been a long trip. And he got picked up by Charlton that day with the professional club in England. And some parents berated me because I left him in England for 10 days and he just turned 13. And they're like, days in Charlton Football Club, and it really, I knew I could leave him there because I've been preparing him for that. You know, as an 8-year-old, I treated him like he was 12. When he was 12, I treated him like he was 16. Because I was a single dad, he had to come to the field every night at the beginning, so he did extra training sessions. Sometimes he would do 3 training sessions a night. At 12 years old, we started training him like 18, and then we just brought him in here and beat him up. Love it. Push his face in the mud and come back to the ball. You know, and that's kind of what I was intended to talk about. So, you know, for Gabe, his pathway is a little bit different from mine, but it is the same. Around 9, 10, and 11, he started putting in the hours. If the kids have 2 training sessions a week, I always ask them, that's 3 hours. What are you doing for the rest of the week? Are you doing some strength and conditioning, speed work? Are you going out to the park on the weekend? Are you getting your brothers to play? You know, you can't expect them to do anything if you're only doing it for 3 hours a week. No matter what you're doing, you're going to be a parent still at home. You can actually put those hours in. And so for me, I want him to breathe. I never force him to do anything. I don't think that works. I don't think making a kid do something and forcing him will work. So with Gabe, it was always, I wanted him to do things. And so he started getting the buff for it, and he would train every minute he could. He would train, honestly, sometimes 12 to 15 sessions a week at 13 years old. And he didn't really want to do anything else, you know. And then when he was 15 and 16, he set up 2 trials for him to go to England. Now, through the academy system here at the Rapid, he had already got the attention of the US scouts. He'd been invited to, they have invitations for training camps, ID camps. And all the academy clubs had US scouts come. So they get invited to training camps. And Gabe got invited to a training camp. At the age of 13, he represented Carolina Rapids down in Florida. They do an all-star game. And they just picked the players from the academies. And he was one of 36 kids in our region. He just went down to Florida and played an all-star game in front of all the U.S. national scouts. And they have a U17 tournament there, which is the USA national team in Brazil, England, Portugal, Australia, the first big toughest team. And then from that moment, he was like, I'm going to be a pro. It wasn't, I want to be a pro dad, I'm going to be a pro dad. Right? And his whole, just for him, personally for him, his whole motivation was just to outdo me. That guy couldn't care about materials, monies, laptops, cars. He don't care about it. I mean, his first car, he wants to get one of those little battery cars. But he doesn't care about stuff. He just wants to outdo me. And I think that's great motivation. And so, from going for the worst, I'm not even embellishing this, worst player he's able to pick up, it shows what you can do with hard work. Hard work, passion, and drive. And that's the example that we're talking about, what we're trying to give to our kids, what we want our coaches.
so he went to England for two trials. We were going to Reading, and does anyone know Aston Villa Football Club? Anyone heard of Aston Villa? Okay, so we were going to go to Aston Villa, we went to Reading first, and after 3 days they offered him a scholarship. So he had a 2-year scholarship. So at 16 years old, and now I'll go back to why I raised him as an older person. Because at 16, I took him to England, it's a continent away, going to have a mark, and then from there, and he lives with a host family. And so I had to really know that he was prepared for that. Because not only was he living by himself without his family, he was working in a full-time professional environment. Parents here who played any kind of professional sport in collegiate. Okay, so without going too much into it, that environment is something very difficult to talk about with your kids because it's very alpha male, alpha female. You know, in that environment that you're in, it's very cutthroat, yes. Very competitive, correct? And so we have to prepare our kids to be competitive. You know, I tell my young kids, my new 15, they're 14 years old, I say, if you're not competitive, don't get out of here. You know, be competitive. We want our kids to be competitive. Training should be competitive. And so with Gabe, you know, just imagine parents. Anyone here 16? 14. Okay, so you imagine in 18 months, 2 years, you take your kids to England and say, see it. Because we haven't seen his mom in 2 years. Now I tell her, but we wanted him to be ready. And in the professional environment in England, it is probably the most politically incorrect place on earth, as well as, but it's part of professional sport. And so I need to know that he was ready for that. You know, sometimes with parents that's hard to hear. But that was our plan. So I couldn't have him going over there and playing because he couldn't deal with the... You know what the most impressive thing is? He flies the American flag. He flies it because the Brits are very arrogant. They think they are the best at everything when it comes to soccer. And that's not true. We have some amazing soccer. So the game's over there, it's called the Yank. And so he has to not only fight for himself, he has to fight for the USA. And trust me, he does. You know, there's favoritism with the English guys out there, the England team. You know, the U18, he's a U18 USA national football team. But it's better for their English. You know, it's not true. So he has to, this is a survivor of really he loves it. He's the kind of guy you knock him down, he'll get up again and say, come on, let's go again. And so that's the only thing I did to help his career. You know, got to see the career, and that's where we go. So his journey wasn't too dissimilar from mine. It's been a little bit easier in England, but because there's so many more clubs. Any of the kids can tell me how many professional and adolescent teams are there? Who knows? Yeah. It's a good guess, but actually I don't know.
Second one that Bobby's just been explaining, and from the adults certainly get this more, especially those of you that have played in competitive environments, is the mental toughness that we need to survive. Not just people on the other team whispering in your ear that they are going to break your leg and knee, which happens to me. I can't imagine what they said to you. The people on your own team fighting for your spot, and also what you mentioned to me when we were talking the other day, really, really pushing you to see if you've got a breaking point, because they want to know that you've done, so they can rely on you. So it's mental toughness. That is what he's talking about, mental toughness and hard work.
Can I jump in? Keith, I've got a question for you. When you go to the gym, do you use like weights? Yeah. Do you girls use weights?
Yeah.
Oh no, I mean like the workout gym. Yeah. Okay, so I'm sure you guys are way more intelligent than me. So when we do strength exercises to build up our muscles, what actually happens when we do it? What happens to the muscles? Say that?
They break down.
Okay? So when we do, have you guys done the dumbbells when you do your bicep? Okay? And you want to get the big, you have to rest for 24 hours. And what you do is you break down the fibers and then they rebuild and they get stronger. Okay? That's the same as relatable to our kids. If we don't push our kids to the limit and see how far they can go, we will never know how tough or how good they can be. It's a fine line, but if we don't push them, how will we ever know how good they can be? And we have to do it in the right way. So, if there's one thing I would change here in America compared to England, now people are brutal in our day, and some of us have been locked up with this kind of things. But I think they're tougher. They push in that younger age. They honestly, I believe they're tough to be on. And I think sometimes we don't appreciate that they're tough. And as long as a coach is giving love as well as pushing them, it's not a great recipe. You know, I've done my coaching based on coaching 20 years now. God has been good to me. I've been putting them on the track suits since I was there. So we want to, I raise my kids with tough love. That's how it worked for me. And I coach with tough love. And I think for me, it's simpler not to have gray area in coaching. Gray area doesn't work. It doesn't work for me. It's either black or it's white. It's good or it's bad. You know, when we critique our kids, we need to understand critiquing isn't being mean. We're in a math class. Well, the teacher doesn't say, good job, unlucky, good luck next time. They show you what to do, correct? And it's the same with a coach. If you make a mistake and I tell you what you did wrong, don't take it as an insult. Take it as, embrace it as a good thing. Because when the coach stops talking to you, that's the time to worry. Okay? And then just saying as a coach, I always tell my parents, look, I don't have the luxury of working in an office. So when you say that I'm yelling, I'm actually just projecting my voice. Because I have to speak to someone who's 80 yards away. And so I think there's a difference between yelling. Yelling is like a guy who's crazy. It's just a lie. But the coaches have to be loud. So I used to get a pen, hey, you were yelling at my son. He's like 80 yards away. You know, I can't whisper. I have to be loud. Okay? So just going back to that, we really want to see. We want to see how far our kids can go, our coaches and parents, pushing them all the time, you know, pushing them, and allowing them to embrace things, you know. I don't see why kids are 10, 11, 12 years old can start taking ownership of everything they do, which is knowing what time the game is, packing their bags, packing their own bags, cleaning their cleats. Who cleans their cleats? Are you clinically? So, something like that? Okay. You know, just little things like that. And so, you know, that's what we try and encourage our clients.
I can honestly say that I don't think I've
that's not that is in the old days when it was never. That all goes to the fantasy stuff.
That's it.
Synthetic stuff.
It's
way like a
carry out first passion. So thanks for that, Mario. I hope you guys got something out of that. That was just part one.
I won't keep you waiting.
But you have actually touched on all of these areas already. And this being the second part, the difference in the process to making it here compared to England and the different countries having different challenges, and you touched on that, Bobby. You mentioned about the cutthroat nature, a lot nastier over there. There's more competition, and it costs more kids to play in. There's a lot of high quality out of the field. The issues that we came up with actually when we were chatting the other day for the United States is it's not that there aren't good facilities and good coaches, clubs, players, but there's a very small scouting network. So I'll give you one example before I let Bobby carry on. I've had half a dozen times parents at different stages come up to me and say, I don't think my kid needs to play a club. They're tearing it up in high school, so you know the college coach is going to see them. There's just such a small scouting network. There's a very small window at the top. So I think Bex, there was 13 teams or something. I think there are 20 now. They keep an animal in every game. So it's a much smaller window at the top. In England, you've got 92 professional teams, and then you've got a whole bunch of semi-pro teams below that. And then you've got the geography of this country, which definitely plays into the small scouting network. England's about the size of Georgia. I mean, you can travel from one into the other in 6 hours. Coaches, we're talking about scouting, college coaches, national team scouts, that are at the development academy games, maybe know some players. There's only so many places they can visit. There's only so much of a distance that they can travel. So it's not necessarily being disrespectful to high schools, because you get some great high school teams and great high school players, and disrespectful to any level that's not Development Academy or ECNL. It's really more of a question of network, geography, and then the small window. So what this means is you have a very limited pathway. And Bobby, if you want to talk over, this is what I didn't realise until we spoke the other day, that it was quite as limited as you thought.
Well, so the kids in here, have you all got favourite schools you want to go to, colleges? Chapman.
Penn State.
Penn State. Wow. Anyone else? Yes, you represent you. Look, here's what we have to understand in this country. There have been some changes in recent years. When I first came here in 97, ODP, everyone heard of ODP? That was the thing to do. Unfortunately, ODP is kind of going to get phased out. The big changes came when Jürgen Klinsmann. You're not allowed to answer, only the kids. Who knows who Jürgen Klinsmann is?
The guy won the World Cup.
He's a German, he used to be the coach of the national team. And so, ODP back in the day was a way to get spotted and scouted and go and play in the Olympics, his Olympic development. And what happened is they revamped the whole soccer program in this country. And so US soccer decided that they needed a pathway for kids to go all the way to the national team. And So we are very fortunate in the Rapids. We are one of 70-something academies in England, okay? In America. So there are 70 academy around that clubs, and the Carolina Rapids are one of them. There are hundreds of clubs around the country. But at every USBA and ECNL game, there is a scout that comes to watch. At every academy game that I work with the boys, a scout sits at a table at every game, and we have to give them a schematic, we have to tell them the formation, use players to identify, and he writes notes and everything, and reports back every week to And so the whole idea was with these 70 academies is for the scouts to identify all the kids. And we started that in 17s and 19s, gone down to 15s, and now we've got it down to the 14s and 30s, and then we've got pre-DA at 11 and 12. And so that's a pathway. Now, not all these kids are going to make it to the pro, but I always tell the parents, I feel as coaches, we can guarantee that if they work hard, that there is no reason why they can't get a Division I scholarship. That's very attainable in this country, isn't it? There's so many colleges here. And as parents, oh my gosh, they get a scholarship. Hallelujah. You know, academic, athletic, you know, save you a ton of money, you know. And really, that's the goal. You know, we have so many players at our club. We go into Division I program, Division II, Division III as well. Their life, some save a ton of money. But again, it's what they're willing to do, how much work they're willing to put in, how much passion they have in the game. So really, the reality is now, there are no college coaches ever going to high school game. I support the high school program as a coach, as a director of my club. As a parent, someone's he didn't play middle school or high school because we felt like he was doing a lot of soccer. I felt like he was going to get burnt out. You know, I felt like coaching wasn't good enough at that level. Now, that doesn't mean you can't go. Huff High School is very successful. There's a good school around here. And the kids love it and they have fun. They have their vision. They enjoy that. So I support it. But personally, for me, we had a different plan. But unfortunately, college coaches don't have the time or the resources to go to high school. They might go there for some play or you know, they've got a friend there, but they're quite active. But they're not going out there to look at kids. No matter what the high school coach tells you, I know they tell you, hey, you've got no coach. So, with the USBA and the ECNL, the college coaches and the scouts for the national team, we've got two girls right now who are the 16 and the 18. And what we're trying to do is that very soon there will be a player or two from this club, very soon, and then it will get more. They'll come through and they'll come into our VA program, our ECNL program, and get involved with the national team. I promise you, it's a dream, but it's a dream that's going to happen very soon. You know, with my son, he's come through our system there from 8 years old, and now he's pro in England. And so he came through the Rapids. We've also got two other guys who have gone into the MLS. You know, so it does work. And for you as parents, and I'm not doing this because it's my club, the most important thing is, and he's going to go on to Arthur, but it is the ethos, it is the coaching. When you look at your school, the kids go to, you look at the teachers, don't you? It's about the teachers. And it should be the same at the soccer club. Be patient with the process. What's more important is who's coaching them. Are the kids coaching them with the right fundamentals? Now, if they go through our pre-DA and get them onto our DA, most of the kids on our DA program and the ECNL are going to go to college. If they want to. But some of them will get there and they go, you know what? Something like that. And that's okay too. They don't all want to go to college, but being a the VA, they keep themselves. My U19 team, that I coached last season, I'm a coach of the senior boys, but half of them have already got commitments to Division 1, Division 2. And that's because they have been seen every week. And so at 9, 10, 11, and 12, don't worry what the kids are doing. It doesn't matter. The coaches, the college coaches and the scouts aren't necessarily looking at that age. But they'll start to identify them, but it won't make any difference if what they're doing at that age. I don't know about you guys, but sometimes we see best kids at 9, 10, 11 not turn out to be the best kids at 17. Now, some of them do. It's about developing that much every year. What I love seeing, the stories I love, is a kid that struggled. We go to a game and go, look at them, man, they look 2 years older than us. How many times have you said that? God, my poor Johnny, he's going to get crushed today. And you know, I say it every week too. Up until about 15, the physical side matters. It makes a difference. At around 16, it stops. Big guys and girls stop getting bigger, faster, and the other ones catch them up. And I love the story of the kid that starts off, he's on the bench, he doesn't get much playing time, but we know he's a great player. And at 15, 16, he starts being, well, I think he's on the team, he starts being regular, or he ends up going to college. But you have to be patient. You have to have a 9-year, 10-year being patient. And I know, as a coach, as a parent, it's sometimes hard for us to make. You know, the most difficult thing in our job, we are dealing with two of the most important things in the world, kids and money. Right? We're dealing with your kids, they're your best, and we're dealing with money. You know, so the two important things. And it also sports is subjective. I sit down and watch England play, and when the manager makes it, what kind of you do it? I would have done that. And I know as a parent, you probably said the same thing. You've never done that? I don't believe you. you know that, and we accept that as coaches. You know, sometimes I feel some of my parents have been making me do my job better than I can. I really can. But you know, I accept because it's one of the biggest things in this world. It's sports. We all love sports. We all love. I love everything. But because we're a sports fan, we all think we're experts. And so occasionally I have a team meeting, and I'll ask all my parents what job they have. And they'll tell me the job. And then I tell them, look, I will never come to your office and tell you anything. So I can't. I'm good at it. I've got no experience in it. And although I would accept your critique sometimes and listen to what your feelings are, you have to trust me. You have to trust me that I've been doing this for as a professional coach for 20 years. I'm pretty good at it, and I'm on the same team as you. And I want these kids to be successful. We love them. But sometimes I'm going to say or do things that are going to annoy them. I always tell my parents, at some point in the season, you're all going to hate me. You're going to say, coach, you know, for that, it's not done because I need to do it. We love the kids, but sometimes we have to do things that might upset you. You have to upset the program. You have to trust the process. An example, my boy was on the U14 Academy. He was late to training. Coach sat, not even, sixth game. Went to Florida for a weekend. And played and came back. And so, I didn't say anything. Because I wanted him to take ownership of being late to training and taking his punishment. Now after 6 games, I thought that was a bit too much. I was a little bit excessive. You know? But at the same time, I had to trust what the coach was doing and why he was doing it, and not jump in there and start screaming and shouting. kid's happy. That I don't know why we're on top of that. My boy happy, my kids, my daughter happy, my daughter may suffer. God bless her. She was terrible. But she was tough. Girls are usually tougher than boys, yeah? Yeah, you are. Girl power. My daughter could kick my boy's butt all over the place. She's way tougher than him. Fantastic cheerleader, gymnast. But terrible soccer player. Coach Mother. She would just mark their best play in this. And so, we have to trust our coaches, and I know it's hard to do. Now, at the same time, if you're at a club that doesn't care, and it's all about just money, get them out of there. But if you're at a club that where people care, this man cares, oh my gosh, they have no life. No life. You've got four kids at home. All he does is his kids, his wife, and soccer. He's a soccer junkie. And he kept me up until the early hours of the morning to talk about soccer, and I was sleeping. You've got to be at a club where the coaches have qualification, and there's a pathway. So your kids can get spotted to go to their favorite college. Or maybe one day they might play in the MLS, or they might play in the USL, which are the leagues. There are pro leagues below the MLS where you can play. And if you're a good girl soccer player, you can get scholarships. We have a girl right now, do you know girls? She's in Sweden playing the pro team in Sweden. And she's 17, I want to say. That's what bothers me about it. So if for your kids to get spotted by college coaches, you won't be at middle school, won't be at high school. Unfortunately, ODP is getting phased out. Does anyone do ODP? It's a Olympic development program. You do the ODP. It's a bit stronger on the girls' side because there isn't a big pro league. But we do have the one pro league, and there's pro league like that. The WSL. But obviously, it's more catering to the pro league on the boys' side, which isn't fair, I don't think. But they can only support what can support. But the girls' college program is fantastic.
For whatever reason, it's a little bit confusing, especially considering the pathway. ODP stands for development. What ODP is, what it was, is the safety. I don't know why they decided to call it ODP at the point of
I think it was a route to go to play the Olympics.
Originally, yeah. Yeah. It was a route to go. But basically, it's the state. As Bobby mentioned, as times change, as political change things, as the process change, things just got watered down slightly. Not so much on the south side, as I said. We have two programs that if your child, first of all, wants to go as far as possible and then you want to support us, then we have the process here to facilitate. Ask the kids, let's be honest, has anyone been to come over to the ground? If you go on our website and you can see all the schedule, then you'll come over to watch a candy game. Do you remember the game you watched? So was it with the boys' side? How good? Okay, so you guys need to take your parents. Actually, if my son's okay today, I want to go and watch the Independence play. So kids, ask your mom and dad and say, hey, can we go and see the academy, the game play? It will be easier than the girls play. Those girls are fantastic. Go watch them play. Because now you can look at them and go, wow, I can make them play here. And you can watch them and go, wow, they're awesome. I had a chance to do this. It's the most amazing thing ever. But if we don't take our kids to go watch games, put your hands up, you have to beat the basketball. And then who's meant to see the parents play? Lots and lots of time.
Okay. So, I want you to put your hands straight up. For those of you kids who have seen 20, you're like 20 professional soccer players. You seen 20?
It's TV camera.
No, not TV, live. Live.
Oh,
okay, now I'm going to go down, okay? 15. Live, go to the saving, go to what, you know, okay. 10. Yeah, you got 10? Go ahead, stand in the chair, where are you? Stand in the chair. Come on, stand in the chair. Tell everyone what your name is. Alright, so, alright, now you've got to name the 10 games. Dad's going to help you now. You seen 10 professional games?
They like the independence.
Are you missing the independence? Are you bugging? Fantastic. Do you love watching independence play? It's great. Apart from sometimes I put fingers in the ears and it makes it a bad word. Okay. So for me, guys, this is what I'm really getting at. By the time I was 15, I probably had been to 100 plus professional games, as well as playing 4 or 5 times a week. I used to go and watch Arsenal play and Chelsea, because I'm from North London. You say this thing? Man United. Okay, and then also I used to go, my local team was a team called Wiltshire, which is a semi-pro club. So on a Wednesday night, I used to go, on a school night, so for me, I learned so much by being close to them and studying them. If I'm a centre forward, I'm going to watch a centre forward and see the runs he's made and see what he's doing. Because we want to copy them. We want to emulate them. We want to copy what they do. And when you copy things, you become a better soccer player. You know? I love American football. I think I would have made a great tight end. I really do. I think I would have been up there. No, because I think I've got that physique for it, you know. I feel I would, in my dreams, I would have been there. So that would have been my dream to get tight end. But I've been to see numerous pattern games. You know, because I love jokes, I've been to the basketball. But I learned more by going to a live event. These kids should be going to watch it local colleges. Look, Davidson, you know, in the Forest, got some great schools here. Come watch them. So much fun. So much fun. And you can take home that with you. Yes, sir.
I just made sure Bobby could see. What happens next for the kids? So your child is 9 or 10.
Yeah.
Which is the 11. So what happens with the field side, the number of the players that they move on? What happens if they don't get into GA or CNA at 11? At what point, because obviously there's developmental levels, right? So
correct.
So they aren't ready for that kind of thing.
Correct.
And then all of a sudden, 13, 14, they become the player that they want to be. So can you talk a little bit to the parents to understand what to expect coming down the road in the next few years?
That goes to the core of everything I've been saying. We have to trust the process because they all develop at different stages. I'm talking about mentally, physically, and spiritually. You know, I can give you hundreds of situations where the kids develop late to make it big. And I can give you hundreds of instances where the parents didn't remain patient and kind of got in the way of what they're doing. Can I talk about that?
I've actually got that coming up here.
Okay. But just to go back to your point, sorry, you know, so we're saying that these kids can go to the ID, this ID camps or dates that kids can go. And Liam goes to our staff meetings and he is always working with our coaches, identifying players, girls and boys, who are ready to go to the next stage. And again, with the parents that take the kids and move from club to club just to be on this team, the status, it really doesn't work that way. might not be in the top team right now, but let's just let him see how he develops. I'm sure you guys have seen him maybe your whole career. I think it changes 6 months. You know, for me, the best time is when the kids go away at the new 14, we have tryouts, we have the summer, they're a high school freshman, and then they come back, we get them back in November for a couple of weeks, and I'm like, oh my gosh, what happened? He's grown 6 inches. Do you believe? Or, you know, eating trees or something like that? Because they've gone from this side to this side, also they've got squeaky voices. and then they gain the balance. So we have to know that, but it also goes the other way as well. So again, I was told that the best players on my team, make sure you keep working with these other guys and catch you up. So if you're not willing to push yourself, they will catch you up. And I love seeing the kids. I love the underdogs. They're my favorite. I was an underdog, you know. And so I love the kids that just keeps going. And you just watch those kids turn out to be amazing because they know what it's like to struggle. I have a favorite phrase I use. I spoke to Kevin Lamb. He said, you cannot fabricate desperation. I love that. I love that quote. Because you have to really be desperate to want something, whether it's soccer, whether it's to be, run your own company. You know, we're not only teaching these kids skills of soccer, we're teaching them life skills. And I always say, I always tell my kids, look, no matter what, you're going to be successful. And I always tell them, when you're rich and famous, you remember me, you know, when I need a job, and you've got to be company, you remember me. Because the reality is, most of these kids are going to go, not only into soccer, they're going to go into the other industry. And so we're trying to teach them what they're teamwork, humility, humbleness, all those things I wish I had. I tried my best. And so that's, we'll go back to that about, with our kids, I've seen so many kids that have gone on to the DA or the ECNL, come off it, and gone back on it. I've also seen kids come on late, getting on to the DA or on my U19 team last year, there were four guys that came onto the plate. One of them goes to NYU. That makes a difference. And you know, and the other three have got scholarships. Actually, one's in Germany right now, and working on that program.
When, let's say that it's a kid's dream, let's say it's a parent's dream, when should they be concerned or at least have it in their mind about what level they're playing at, if they're in the DA, if they're in the ECNL or not? And Bobby, correct me if I'm wrong or back me up on this, but if you come back to this, ladies and gentlemen, you have pre-DA starting at U11 now, and then you have DA in 12, and 13, and 14, all the way up to 19. And in a perfect case scenario, you get player coming in at the younger stage, and they go all the way up. It's absolutely magic, and you're looking at the superstar. That happens. So that's the plan. If we're talking about what happens post club, and we're talking about if somebody going to go pro, if somebody going to go to college, limited, right? Small scouting network, geography of the country. U14 and U15, probably U15. My check with 3 Division 1 coaches in the past 2 years. Nobody said U12. Right? It's just, it's not. It's not even on economic. And as one said, players can do that. But, you know,
to where you're going. You know, U15 is probably 7. The kids start to catch each other up. They might find the right track.
So we have a U15, U17, U19. We have two boys in our U15 right now that are in the pool for the U.S. national team. They've got Lucas, who's our goalkeeper, Stevie, who's a midfield player. They both just recently went to train the national team. And we're very excited about that. Because I'm actually helping Lucas. I just come out of the pool, so we can start with Stevie. And I'm so proud about my son. My son kind of opened a lot of avenues for everyone. I will tell you, when he was in 16 Academy, he wasn't a star goalkeeper. He wasn't a star goalkeeper. He had a guy who was older than him, who was a star keeper. And we had to be patient. I didn't go knock on the door. Why is my boy playing? You know, the guy's at but we have to be patient with our kids. College coaches aren't looking at anyone, typically, until they're kind of juniors. Now, if they're not in the DA or the UCNL, has anyone ever heard of the Disney tournament? Are they not in the film? Oh, it's fantastic. I love it. I absolutely love it there. I've been so much time with my kids. We go there, and it's fantastic. Number one tournament in the country. So not only can you make it through our club and Liam's club by going through the pre-DA, DA, but we also have our Bergman team on the boys and girls side that go to the big showcases, Castle, Jefferson Cup. I'm actually this weekend going to Jefferson Cup in my team. There will be tons of coaches there. Now they won't be looking at my youth team, mostly the 17s and the 18s. And a lot of kids get recruited from there. And so, even if they're not in the DA, they have to be at a club that has gone to these big showcases. And they have to be at a club where the coaches and the ethos is all pulling in the same direction. You know, no disrespect, but unfortunately, our job is like one for teachers. It doesn't pay very much. You know, and most of the coaches do it, say, love sport and love kids. The only other thing I do is be a social worker. So it's hard to get good coaches. It really is. Yeah, it's because, you know, just like a lot of teachers quit because they can't afford it, and they go into another industry, and that's such a shame. You know? And so some of these little clubs, unfortunately, they have people who care, or they're just not qualified. You know, I get a kid who will come from a club and maybe 16 years old, and he hasn't been taught. You know, Liam's job here at this club, he coaches, teaches kids the fundamental technical stuff, and get them prepared to where they're going to. And that's a lot.
Bobby, you've already touched on some of this as well, so we've got a maximum of 20, 25 minutes left. And you've already touched on this somewhat. Your pet has been saying, and rub it in the and you actually said this, you said this earlier on, which was my question to you, above all else, what are you? I think you already talked about this, your first year as a parent compared to the following years, and what became your priority, which was support the game. And then,
yeah, I will say one thing. I wanted them to be a hypocrite. And so when I watch my son play, did you guys get excited? I never want to. Mums, I love seeing the mum grab something that I know they can't take off the top of the door and they're screaming in. And then they all clap and someone gets to get a car. Well, I made a promise to my boy that I would always stand as a goalkeeper, I would stand on a 6-yard, on a 6-yard box. But I wouldn't say anything. I had a little noise I would make. And he can hear it from the mic. It's like, so when we already showed the thing off, I said, you hear this one, get them up here. And so in the game, he does something good. And that was just
out of respect to coaches, who's out of respect to the son, and out of respect to the parents. Parents used to say that, I think, well, like, I don't know. I just don't want to talk about your son, to my son, you know. So I would just go and watch him. And I think the kids appreciate the mum and dad. Just support them. Don't judge them. Don't blame them for anything. Have the kids got the car with you guys, and just sit back there. And as soon as you say something, they lash out. You've had that. You don't know what you're talking about. Have you all had that? And so I always find that as kids, we always take out our frustration with people who have nothing like this, mom and dad. And so I give my kids a little bit of advice. You should be telling mom and dad, give up. Give dad a kiss. I'm going to take a kiss to heart and talk to them. So Gabe and I, our relationship developed where I said, I'm not going to speak until he speaks. The first year, I was going to be crazy. What are you doing? And all that, just, I was like Will Ferrell, like, his hands up and dropping in. And I had to take a step back and go, look, I'm a coach and a parent. I need to set some standards here. And so I always tell my parents, come to the game, cheer, shout, have fun, and scream when they score. Don't clap when they get cars out. And, you know, but don't critique the other players. That was another thing. My boy got the car and he started to speak about another player. Stop. You want to hear it. Not your place to be on your team. And you say something nice. Okay. And so we want to make sure that our kids come to the class.
Real quick, Bobby, because it was interesting and you wanted to talk about real quick, describe this meeting last week.
Yes.
That opposite one.
Are they husband and wife with you right now? Are they husband and wife? Okay. So last week I had a meeting with a kid that's just come off our U17 VA program. He's actually a true U16, so he's playing up. And so he's just come off it, and we put him onto our U17 Birmingham team. But as a senior board director, I felt his development wasn't working for him because he was playing up a year. And not really being one of the top players. In order for a player to play up, does anyone here play up in A group? You must be a rock star. What's your name? Tell me, what's your name? In what position do you play? Are you a rock star?
I've never seen him.
So, for our players to play up, they must be a star. They must be in an environment where they're too good, so they need to go and be challenged. And so this boy was playing up, but he was struggling in that age group. So I sat down with the parents. Now, both parents were Division I athletes. So, you know, I braced myself, you know. And mum, God, she was fantastic. She just got it. Dad, it was like me the first year. Bro.
He's been at the A.
You know. So I had one mum who got about the development and do this for his woman. Kind of trust us. We're not doing this for punishment, we're doing it for him to get better. If he trusts us and get better, then work his way back up. But dad couldn't let go. Dad, it was dad who was thinking about that. Hey, I'm gonna be one hand. Sink through your brother's looking glasses and trust his development. And people, and it's hard to tell a parent, it goes down and you need to get around. And so that for us is why we feel like we need to educate our parents as much as our kids. So that was very interesting. He was facing that way and she was looking that way, but he was facing that way. He talked to me looking that way. So I knew I was in big trouble. We have moved him down, by the way.
We've all had it. You also touched on this, so I hope, guys, we should be out of here on time. Bobby has actually touched on
it. Am I boring you yet? One of this. That's why I love you, to tell you the truth.
So in terms of player development,
you already know that Gabe was not playing for the Asia 2 and was not always the best kid on his team, even when he came to the club in a long time. You said this a lot already, Bobby. What are the chances of that?
Yes. We did plan for something.
You do it and things are probably going to work out. You don't do it, things are probably not going to work out. I don't know some problems.
Okay, who's going to back? All right, so the guy we bought. Right. So how many times a week do you train? Twice. Okay, and on a normal week, we play one game a week. Yeah. All right, so that's three times. Now, if you go to two training sessions, of the 100% work, what percentage are you getting? Someone help them out. Come on. You get one of the parents. If you have two training sessions in the game and you do the full two training sessions, what percentage of the week work? Here's my point. So every kid can go to two training sessions and get 66.6% of the week's work, correct? If they play half the game on Saturday, okay. And the other 12.5% of the time, sitting on the bench and you're watching the game, correct? So are you learning? So you've got two training sessions, you play half a game and you watch the game. So where's it gone? Unfortunately, sometimes the parents just see the game. They don't see the training. They don't hear the communication. So they judge everything. My son only played half a game. You're a terrible coach. You should be fired. The most important thing is training. When our kids at the DA do four training sessions a week at the game, they get 80% of the week's work. Everyone gets it. They go to four training sessions because they're monthly. And then the weekend, they play half a game. They're getting 90% of the week's work. And the other 10%, they listen to the coach and they watch the game. That's irrelevant. It's not about the game. It's the training. Training is the most important thing. Games will come.
Good, get that shot of practice.
God, you maybe couldn't have done good at that.
Yeah, who knew? I would never have guessed that. I would never have guessed that. Alright, so, I think this is the last, yes, this is the last one. So, we've been talking primarily about, Bobby's been talking about primarily what it takes to make it to the top. Him as a pro, his son as a national team player, you guys potentially wanting to go to college or play pro. If that is what you want, what do they need to look at for me and at what age? I'm sorry if that's vague. My question is, you already touched on this as well. What club, type of club, priorities in a club, should they be looking at, and at what age? Obviously, if they want to go as far as they can, they have to have those pathways. You mentioned a couple of these points. What should the parents be looking at?
Parents, it's really important that you do your research. Do your research and go online. So, unfortunately, as I say, the system has been watered down by too many look around for lots of different clubs. And basically a lot of guys who are just got egos and want to be
where the success is going to be. These guys have had qualifications and badges, we've gone and really studied. You know, we do education sessions all the time. We did an education day with a marriage doctor. You're sending them to Canada for a reason. You're sending them because they have the opportunity to go further. So, you know, so we bet our teachers, we need to do the same thing with your coaches. And it's important to be with a club that is linked to something where you have the best opportunity to be successful. And not only be successful, but also have a great time. If you don't want to go to fun, if you don't want to be a pro, you just want to have fun. You want to be in an organisation that knows what they're doing. I cry when I go to all the other clubs and I see what goes on. The gate is really grown to the
me, I started Carolina Soccer Club with the help of some fantastic people in this room. And then, when making the decision to partner with the Carolina Rapids, create that pathway, there was only one thing that mattered to me, and that was, why are we doing this? What's the ethos? What's the point? What are the life lessons? What's the bigger picture? And it took time to come up with, but it did come up with it, and it's black and white on our website if anyone wants to look. We've been there for quite a while, and I encourage you to look at it. Yes? Any parents here, do you actually go to the website and read the book? You do. And I encourage you to know that if you'll tell me, you and I live in Colorado, felt like a month. That education that we are giving to our coaches, what Tom's doing, is giving us access to the market. You know, when we go for 5 days and sit, I'm telling you, all day in the stadium, in the rooms upstairs, talking about kids, coaching, you see the love in the room from the coaches, it is phenomenal. You know? And as I said, I'm 52 years old, still learning. I've been in this game 45 years and I'm still learning about this game. I'm still learning how to communicate with these guys, how to work with them. If I had a boy or a girl, what age is it? You guys have to deal with maybe one or two teenagers. In a season, I deal with 5 to 6 teenagers. That would be a great thing. You know, and so whole part of our thing is how we communicate. You know, I have a lot of young coaches and I spend half my time mentoring them because they don't know. They don't know how something like that. You know, but what I've seen with Liam is his love for state. He's always, him and I talked the other day, has anyone read the article? Name the author, I'm going to say something. Man, did a presentation of that book. If you ever want to read a great book, it's from the planet, one of the things I've read. I read that book. And it's relatable to
soccer, basketball, football, whatever, I'm sure you've come across it. The most important thing is doing your research on the coaches, on the club, what the mission statement is, their aims and ambitions.
And this will be the final one. Thank you, Bobby. Speaking of that, on the first page of the Carolina Soccer Club Philosophy's Handbook, this is a direct quote from the technical director of one of the best academies in the world. Notice that he doesn't talk about red passing or red dribbling or red shooting. That was really important. Notice what his focus is. You guys should have had plenty of things when we talk about what we are trying to do, the characteristics of red trying to encourage in the kids, both on and off the field. And that, before we start Carolina Soccer Club, and then that is why we partner with the Rapids, because the philosophies are so simple. We want to help the kids become decent. And if we can do that through soccer and at the same time we can do great soccer players, that's the truth. This is what we want. I think it's a good mission, and for me it's never going to change. Bobby, thank you for coming out and validating everything I then said to all of these guys. I just did it in a different voice. I really appreciate it. Guys, does anyone have any specific questions for Bobby? We are right. What is your question? I apologize.
So the big question is, did I have any bad injuries in my career? I used to have my own parking space at the hospital. And the reason I know is, my son had to do a project. After the project and all the injuries. So we sat down, and by the end of it, I looked at him and I thought, oh my gosh, I've broken so many bones. And, you know, if I go through everything, you know, if I broke a nose, it's broken cheek, broken jaws, head. Broken collarbone, hernia, multiple knee operation. But I had a wonderful career. It was hard. So to answer your question, yes, I did. But it's part of soccer, you know. When you're with a young kid, they don't get too many injuries. Probably the three major things they get are shin splints, Oscars, and what's the other one? They get usually their heels and their arches, and then the knees get the sore.
That was your question. You didn't want to see a job again.
My worst injury was.
That's not basketball about.
I can't go home in tears.
I don't know if anyone here has anyone here broken a rib. Okay, there is nothing worse than breaking your rib. If you sneeze, it hurts. If you breathe, if you do a toot, it hurts. You know, so, yes, broken ribs. I've had broken ribs and played with them. It's not fun. So.
Because we...
There's some violent questions here.
I know, they just want to see... They just want to know you hurt. Guys, I'll ask you in just a second, kids, if you don't mind, we'll come to the front and get a photograph with our guest. But if you don't mind, would you mind saying thank you to him a round of applause?
I haven't been bored too much. I know the kids are fantastic sitting here, but I hope it was very beneficial and helpful to you guys. I mean, that's the whole idea for being with you, so thank you.
Bobby, thank you. I appreciate it.
Kids,
come up to the front. Let's get right in front of this screen. Tell you what, Bobby.
Crush it. Who's the best team in England?
guys, it doesn't have to be perfect, but get yourself in some sort of order so we can get you on it. Yeah, maybe the front row take a knee. Maybe the front row take a knee. Noah, Levi, take a knee.
There you go.
Back up a bit, Hannah.
Have you over some time? I think I am.
Bobby, stop talking about food. Alrighty. Alright, guys. Alright, on the count of three, we want to say Bobby, yeah? 1, 2, 3.
Bobby!
Okay. Bobby, actually, could you move a little bit that way and see if you sit up just a little bit, because it's a little, your face is dark. Alright, ready? Scooch back again, kids. Alright. See if I can put the flash on. There we go. Alright. 1, 2, 3.
Bobby!
Oh, you got a half Bobby. You got a half Bobby. Hey guys, thank you for giving up your time.
Thank you.